The Talbot Hotel. More than just a Chicago Gold Coast hotel, the Talbot Hotel is a full-service boutique hotel offering the charm of a gracious bygone era coupled with all of today's modern conveniences.
Voss, artesian water from Norway. Splendidly still or luxuriously sparkling. Voss, artesian water from Norway.
I got to know Staub through Alain Ducasse. Getting one for the first time and then cooking with it was a wow moment for me. What sets it apart, the construction and durability of it, the craftsmanship that goes into it, the history that goes into it. I mean, it goes back to Paul Bocuse. It's like the Mercedes-Benz of cookware for me almost.
It's wonderful to have you here. It's a beautiful, I'm going to say summer day, because we didn't really get a summer in full. So today is, wow, look at all these wires. Today is a beautiful summer day, so thank you for being here. I hope you had a great summer. I did. I've been working really hard on my podcast, The Dinner Party to Go, which has been picked up by WGN. So it's very exciting for that. Oh, what a lovely crowd. Wow, everyone's in a great mood. Yes, so I hope that you subscribe. Go to WGNplus.com to subscribe. So for those of you who are here for the first time, my name is Elizabeth Alfano, and I'm your host of The Dinner Party. And what I do on The Dinner Party is I invite three celebs and a prominent chef who cooks for us and you. So that means tonight we're having ricotta tart from Chef Michael Taus of Taus Authentic. Yay, Michael Taus. We're having Slagle Farm flat iron grilled steak in his secret chimichurri sauce, which is great. We've got bread and cheese from Roth Cheese. We've got Lifeway frozen kefir treats and cupcakes on the way. So, and of course, great wine from City Winery. So you're going to have a full feast tonight, which is great. But that's not the only thing. In addition to eating together, just like any good dinner party, we're talking together. We're in conversation together. So there are two ways to be a part of this conversation tonight. And I do want to hear from everybody. So I hope you'll partake. You can kick it old school, circa 1812, and you can write on the index cards on your tables your question for anybody on stage, and then write your name also as well in your email. And then as soon as you're done with that, raise your hand, and my lovely interns will come and get your index card and take it to Allie Drum, my social media director, right there in the corner, and she's going to search through all your questions and pick a couple for us to have on stage. So you can do it that way, or you can pull out your handy-dandy cell phones, and you can send me a tweet at dinnerpartychgo, hashtag the dinner party, dinnerpartychgo. And again, Allie and I will pick the tweets, and if your tweet is picked to be a question on stage, you're winning $50 at Taus Authentic. Just saying, it's money, it's real money. You're winning $50 at Taus Authentic. You're winning CDs and t-shirts and signed books and theater tickets, great stuff. So it definitely pays to tweet, and you want to do this. And it pays to participate, because it's fun. It's fun. But you are not alone. As you know, we are streaming tonight on the Chicago Sun-Times Splash section. So welcome to everybody watching us on the Sun-Times Splash session. We are sold out, as you can tell. Full packed house, like always, actually. So if your friends did not get tickets tonight, you can tell them to watch us at chicagosplash.com/thedinnerparty. So, okay, go ahead. Familiarize yourself with index cards if you really need that. And get your phone on Twitter. I'm going to go ahead and thank my sponsors, and then we're going to get rocking and rolling. So, Thank you to Voss Water, who hydrates us in style. They've been with me for years, and I love them. Staub Cookware, the best French cookware you could ever have. All my chefs love them. Thank you to Windy City Times, one of my media sponsors, and of course, Chicago Splash. They are wonderful. The very lovely and elegant Talbot Hotel is a big supporter, and I love them. And then we've got somebody new on the docket. If you look at your tables, you should have index cards that talk about Reserve.com. So Reserve.com is a new app where you can make a reservation for a restaurant, and if you put in the words "the dinner party," you get $20 off. It's more money. So put in "the dinner party" and you'll get $20 off the first restaurant that you go to. So that's pretty cool. So thank you to all those wonderful people. And then in addition, I wanted to thank and acknowledge the Chicago Academy for the Arts. You know, we try to do a charity event. I love them. We try to do a charity event before every dinner party. And I think so highly of the Chicago Academy for the Arts, and I'm really happy to support them here. You know, there's only 4 high schools like them in the United States where they take exceptional students and they give them a chance to fulfill their dreams in academia and the arts. And there's only 4 high schools like that, really, in the United States. So I'm thrilled to have them here, and we're going to have a little secret from them at the very end of our dinner party tonight. But, okay, enough logistics. You should be online and should be ready to have your questions. So let's get on with our show. My first guest, taking the world by storm, I kid you not, Chicago local and hometown favorite, critically acclaimed international pop artist, Heber Brantley's in the house. I'm going to put you right there. You are right there, and you may sit. My next guest is hot off a plane from London. She's a former model and actress, and for the last 50 years, she's been stealing glances with her camera, fantastic photography of some of the most iconic figures of the 1960s and 70s. The song by the Rolling Stones, "Faraway Eyes," that's about her. Please welcome the very lovely, our British friend, Corinthia West. Have a seat right there. So this next guy, he calls himself a nomad, both in his life and in his career. He's a designer, he's an entrepreneur, and he started some little thing called Kickstarter. Please welcome co-founder of Kickstarter, Charles Adler. Right there. I'm gonna go over here now. So of course, I would be remiss if I did not say that the wonderful Chef Michael Taus of Taus Authentic is also here in the house, slaving away for us right now. And I think everyone's starting to get their food, so you know what I mean when I say he's really talented. Let's take a peek into the kitchen and see just what Chef made for us tonight.
Hi, I'm Michael Taus from Taus Authentic Food and Drink in Wicker Park. I'm excited to be cooking today for the dinner party with Elizabeth Alfano. Here at Taus Authentic, we do contemporary American, a little bit of global influences. You know, I had Zealous Restaurant for 20 years, and now we're doing a new venture, something a little bit more casual, same elevated food, same great service. Today, we're gonna be cooking a regatta tart, something dear to my heart. My grandmother used to make these. We've pre-cooked these tarts this morning, so I'm just gonna pop this in the oven just to warm it up a little bit. Then we're gonna make the salad. We're gonna take a little bit of the green olive, black olive, and the tomatoes. I have some wonderful white balsamic, which I have extra virgin olive oil, a little bit of honey in there. Then I'm going to grab that tart. It's just not super hot, but just a little bit above room temperature. Just makes a nice creamy texture. So we're going to cut it just so we can do a kind of a nice presentation. I like odd numbers, so we're going to do 3 across the plate. So then we're going to take the arugula. We're going to do a little smear across the plate. Then we're going to put our tart on there. Then we're going to take this great little salad and some great flavors and textures. We're gonna take some of those toasted walnuts, just kind of break them up on the plate a little bit. Then we're gonna take arugula, just kind of like whimsically across the plate. And once we're to this point, I'm gonna take a little bit of lavender honey that we make in the restaurant. And in the very end, we have some really nice aged Romano. And then we have the wonderful tart.
Zealous for about 20 years,
yes.
And then you opened Taos Authentic. Tell me why.
You know, Taos, we had Zealous for 20 years, and our rent started going up, and I decided to do something new and exciting. I also wanted to do something a little bit more casual, but elevated food. So I took 2 years and did a bunch of consulting, and actually got to spend some time with my wife.
You know,
four months consulting, cool trip for 10 days, three more consulting. Another trip, so we travel around the world, France and Hong Kong and Portugal and Spain, and got a lot of great ideas and kind of recharged my battery, and it's kind of fun doing that that way, yeah?
Well, so something that I noticed about Chef when we were doing that film is that he was very secretive about his ricotta tart. So I know that this is an old family recipe that you didn't want to give up. And so yeah. I wanted to ask you, how important is family tradition for you in cooking?
Growing up, a very active kid. So my grandmother was Sicilian, and we'd cook all the time. And I just loved that, as a little kid, to be able to twist and turn dough and be able to eat it. And that was fascinating. My father's a frustrated chef, and my grandfather cooked, and so everybody in our family, everything's about eating. We'd be making breakfast and say, what's for lunch? I was very lucky, and plus my great-grandfather had a giant farm, so as a little kid, they had goats and geese and grew all this stuff, and my dad actually at 18 years old used to sell like Purple Cherokee and corn and different things off the back of a truck for fun to make some money, and before there was a Green City Market, so farming is dear to my heart, so.
Well, so if this isn't crazy enough, when did you open Taos Authentic? May of this year?
February 11th.
February of this year, and then you just opened a bar.
Because my friends kind of me into it. my friends are like, hey, we have this great deal about buying a building. It has a bunch of apartments and a couple billboards. By the way, there's a restaurant you have to run. It's just kind of fun bar food, everything from scratch. It's been really quite interesting, and all my partners are 30 years old or a little younger than me, so I feel like the big brother, and so I'm teaching everybody, and it's kind of fun because some are lawyers, some are real estate guys, and everybody's really passionate and excited, so it's kind of fun.
Well, I think this speaks to the craziness of chefs, because you have to work such incredible hours, and then who in their right mind would open a restaurant and a bar in the same year?
I think lots of us do that. Yeah. But I think the best part, like tonight, we have a bunch of kids from Washburn culinary school in the kitchen with us, and it's like a little army, and that's why we all do this, because I love to teach. I'm actually on the board of directors of the Trotter Project.
Sure.
Charlie Trotter, I knew how to cook very well when I went into Trotter's kitchen, but he taught us also how to be good humanitarians, giving back. And I think that's a big thing for us. We're doing mentorship, internship, and scholarships, and I think it's so important to teach these kids and help them get a profession so they can, I would say it's kind of like, if you could give somebody a fish, but if you teach them how to fish,
sure.
They could feed their family for the rest of their lives. And that's, I think, what's happening back there tonight is these kids are so passionate, really excited,
right.
And we're doing some really cool stuff, and they haven't seen before, and they're already asking to come in our kitchens.
Oh, that's awesome. So we've got a bunch of interns in the kitchen, and they're already making connections. But okay, speaking of the kitchen, I know that you have lots of work to do on our entrees, so you're going to be back in the kitchen, but we're going to have you belly up to the table in a little bit.
Great.
We'll have you back.
Okay,
thank you, Chef.
Cook. I'll be back.
Thank you, Chef. Thank you. Chef Michael Taos. Okay, so when I do these dinner parties, what I try to do is I try to find something in common that maybe you didn't know yourselves. So what I found in common when I was doing the research on the three of you is that you all have a very special space and time that you've really capitalized on. So I'm watching this series that I love called Halt and Catch Fire, which is about on AMC. Who's seen this series? Oh, I'm addicted. I'm surprised there aren't more of you. Okay, Halt and Catch Fire, and it's basically about when they these firms were developing small computers to go into that house. And you could easily take out these small Dell compact sort of businesses and replace it with things like Groupon and Kickstarter. There was a very special time around 2008, 2009, when you sort of felt the zeitgeist and started what really caught on. And clearly for you, Corinthia, as well, you've taken so many iconic photographs of stars of the 1960s and 70s, celebs, rock stars. So there's that magical time in the 60s and 70s that has captured us and we can't really let go of. And then for you, you've captured a very special time, which is a fictional time, because you have your flyboy iconic character that's really based on the Tuskegee Airmen. We've got pictures of these. I'm sure Clara can throw some up. And it's a magical time. It's a superhero time. It's a fictional time. But you've created this special sort of space and time in your artwork. And I wanted to ask each of you, I'm going to start with Charles, but I hope that you all sort of jump in. I wanted to ask you why you think right at that time you were able to resonate with people. So what did Kickstarter do that was just so topical right then?
Ooh. You mean in 2009?
Yeah, when you were starting.
I don't bloody know. I'll relay this one story or anecdote from that period, which was, I'll channel a little bit of my father through this conversation. When I was, you're trying to describe this thing that you're working on, which doesn't sound like much of anything, and you're sort of describing it in the way I'm maybe describing this right now, sort of stumbling through it. He didn't bloody get it. He's like, why the fuck would anybody give money to a random person? I was like, oh, right. And so, what lit it on fire? I don't really know. But other than the fact that I think, especially for the three of us, there's three of us who started the company. I think we knew in our heart of hearts that there was this something missing in the world, and there was a lot of work that was missing in the world. And we had this little hypothesis that then grew into a big hypothesis.
And did you get funders and backers?
Meaning investors?
Yes.
Yeah, so, early on it was a lot of, I don't know how people know in the audience the world of doing a tech startup, but there's sort of this undercurrent that tends to happen, which is those who've started a company recognize how bloody horrible it is to start a company,
yeah.
Or also empowering, but it's also really tough.
Depends on the day.
Yeah.
Depends how you feel.
Exactly. It's actually super psychotic. So I think there's definitely this attitude of sort of giving back, right? Uh-huh. And so we had a lot of those initially, other past entrepreneurs who hadn't been successful who had initially funded the idea of Kickstarter. And then later on, a few institutional, but yeah.
And so, but you were able to resonate with them.
I would actually argue is a lot of the attitude for them was very similar to anybody who's running a campaign, mm-hmm. which is I see a little bit of myself in you.
You mean the Kickstarter campaign?
Yeah, like somebody who's running a campaign right now. I actually describe the connection between somebody supporting a campaign and somebody launching a campaign, running a campaign. Like it's a very emotional, you're putting yourself out there,
sure.
Right? No different than anything you've ever done that's very personal. And I sort of describe that money is just simply conduit for something actually far more important, and that is something called love, mm. Right? This sort of expression of trust, but maybe even deeper than trust, they sort of trust that you're gonna get it done, which mm-hmm. is a very pragmatic thing, but are excited and sort of living vicariously through the guts that you've put out mm-hmm. on the internet.
So I'm surprised because I would have thought you would have said what Kickstarter means to me. So I thought you would have said something closer to what you just said now, which I guess is Kickstarter and Groupon in a way, but really Kickstarter. For me, maybe there were others out there and I just didn't know about them, was the first time the internet helped me take control of my life.
What's the Groupon connection?
Well, just because Groupon through crowdsourcing, you end up getting a deal. Originally,
gotcha.
When now Groupon's changed, but originally you could get, if enough people joined in, you'd all get money off.
So you guys were
all making this internet community work for you. And so here, whereas okay, there was Match.com and there was Facebook and you were meeting people, so the internet was connecting like that. Yep. But it wasn't working for me. Mm. And with Kickstarter, I felt like, okay, now I don't have to go to a bank. Now I'm no longer the little guy. Yep. Kickstarter was empowering me.
Well, so I will say that actually, so you mentioned Groupon. Groupon, there's an interesting story with Groupon, which is, did anybody know what Groupon was before Groupon? It was this thing called The Point.
Oh, right, I did hear that, yeah. Yes.
And it was sort of very similar, akin, a similar attitude to Kickstarter, a little bit different, mechanics were different. And that was sort of certainly a differentiator. I think, I've lost my train of thought as I usually do.
And we haven't even had drinks yet, really.
Yeah, actually, I have, but you know, whatever.
Well, you were talking about the connection to Groupon, a short story.
Well, here's what I would say. It was in the water. So this idea, the term is crowdfunding. It's sort of out there. There's a number of different players. There's a company called Fundable, which launched like 3 years before we had. And so what's interesting, and I think we would probably see this in all of our disciplines, which is there's sort of a continuity going on, right? Mm-hmm. It's called movement or whatever you want to call it. Number of people have a similar idea, right? A hypothesis, and they're all sort of putting their own expression of that hypothesis into the world. They're mm-hmm. transacting that idea into a real object, whether it be a photograph or a painting or a website or whatever. Joie de vivre, I don't know, like whatever it was that we put into it seemed to work, which I know is a very sort of evasive answer, but I can get into some like nerdy technicalities that are really going to kind of like turn the conversation down to here.
Okay, we're just going to bum everyone out. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, well, do you still work in Kickstarter? You don't really. You're not really involved.
Not day to day, but right. On more like strategic kind of level, yeah.
On a strategic level. Well, okay, so...
In my heart.
Yes, of course. So, Corinthia, I want to ask the same question of you, but maybe before I do, maybe Clara can cue up a video for a second, because, you know, I'm wondering your photographs, what you've captured from these iconic celebrities over the years, really, really, you know, touches people, and I'm wondering what you think it is about that magical time in the 1960s and 70s that everyone is still so captivated with, particularly Britain, 1960s and 70s. But before we do that, I want to show you Corinthia's video so you all have a sense for really who and what she is in full.
In full.
We also have a very foxy lady here to talk about the late 60s and the 70s, Corinthia West.
Yeah, it's extraordinary. I don't quite know how it happened. You know, I was a model, an actress. This was my antidote, the camera. It was very easy to be part of the gang. They were just friends, of course, so you were just taking pictures of people you were hanging out with.
Oh, Corinthia's got her camera, great, you know, whatever. She can take pictures while we're getting on with life.
You know, this work is really stunning, and I don't think none of her friends, who've known her for a very, very long time, quite entirely understood the kind of the level of the work that she was doing.
I love the way Corinthia captures the warmth, and there's such humanity with her pictures. They're so expressive.
Downtime, you just see him being a geezer, and like that's a geezer having a laugh. That one, you know.
So now that we sort of have a sense, just in case some of you didn't know, what is it about that time that resonated so much with people almost after the fact?
Well, I think you were touching on the fact you were talking about love and trust. Mm. I think it's a huge change now, because everyone can take a photograph anywhere, flash it around the world in a second. There's no privacy as we knew it then anymore. And I think one of the things that we had then, I mean, it was a day of a time of perhaps more innocence, not to say there wasn't terrible things happening in the world, but there was a sort of implicit trust in if you were known to certain people, you were hanging out with, you know, you took a picture, and I was never personally ever thought I would show these pictures. They were going to stay in my scrapbooks and languish in my boxes in the attic with the mice eating at them, you know.
Well, because you recently brought them out. These were...
Well, that was sort of what I was saying. The younger generation, that's what was so heartening for me. I have many, many godchildren and many friends with children and cousins with children and all sorts of children. I don't have children myself, but I'm very much around a lot of young. And they loved them. And every time I sort of... They went, oh, I can't believe you were there. You know, you were hanging out with George Harrison. You knew the Rolling Stones. You know, they think they're dead now, but you know. You know, it was sort of that enthusiasm and care for our time in a way that inspired me to take, because we took so much for granted. I mean, I hate to say it, but that was just what we did those days. You know, it wasn't like a big deal. Like now we're such a self-conscious generation.
Right.
You know, everybody has to look fantastic and have to display themselves and exhibit and talk about and talk it up and media and all of it. Not that that's wrong, it isn't, but it just wasn't like that then. So if that is an answer, I hope it is.
No, I think you've really hit on something that I didn't really fully form in my head until you just said that. I think the difference is that they were just naturally hanging out. They weren't intentionally posing. They weren't taking a selfie. Yeah. They weren't trying to create. It's a question I'll have for Chef later. Sometimes I wonder, do people even care about the food, or are they just photographing the food to say that they were near it? Yeah. I'm not kidding. I wonder if people are even eating everything that they're photographing.
Yeah.
And it's
a lot to that.
Fake, really.
Yeah.
And so much of what you've captured here is really just people.
Well, for one thing, you know, it took so long to get, if you had a film, you obviously didn't have digital, so it was a film camera. But by the time you'd loaded in the film, you know, taken pictures, oh my God, did they come out? You'd run down to, if you did them yourself, that took a while, or you ran to the lab, and that, you know, by that time, it's sort of 5 days have gone by.
Yes, right, sure. I remember waiting for pictures from Walgreens or whatever, yes.
And also, that very nature of that non-immediacy creates a trust because, you know, and I think one important thing is that every single person I have on my exhibition has been contacted by me, shown the picture. Many of them are still dear friends. Some of them, sadly, are dead. I've talked to their estates, wives. I feel you have to have respect when you photograph someone for that moment. And quite often, someone will say, I'd really rather you didn't show that one. Maybe you can do it in 5 years' time, but for me, it's still a bit personal or something, and you just respect that.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. There's other occasions, I won't say who they are, but everyone will be amused that, you know, they've had a facelift since I took the picture. Had a teeth fixed, you know, or they think they look as if they were in rehab, and now there's, you know, or whatever it is. And so, you know, but people change. People are people. They mutate and... But I'm very heartened by the excitement and enthusiasm that I've received. Having not been a professional photographer, I was professional actress, professional model, professional journalist, but photography, I did very few professional jobs. So this is a kind of kitchen table second career. This is the second career.
It's wonderful. All of her photographs are at the Hilton Asmus Gallery at 1702 North Wells. And we have a prize involving that gallery coming up. But if you get to see them, I hope you will see them. You're seeing them here on screen. But if you get to see them really at the gallery, it's wonderful because I think, as you say, that level of trust has really let those iconic figures show themselves to you. And so they're really, really wonderful.
Well, thank you.
But so for the same question that I have for the two of them, I want to ask you as well, why do you think Flyboy touches so many people?
You know, I'm trying to figure that out every day.
Is that right?
Everyone, you know, art is one of those things that, you know, depending upon the person, their experiences from that day, it affects people differently. And I think that for me, naturally being a storyteller, wanting to tell stories, you know, as a kid wanting that attention and, you know, when the spotlight is on you, wanting to be able to tell the best story. I think that through the work, you know, being very narrative was extremely, extremely important to me. And I don't want to become too heavy-handed, you know, sometimes where it sort of off-puts the audience, but I wanted something that, you know, would be easily digestible, but I could say anything I wanted. Uh-huh. I could say, you know, I love you, fuck you, I hate you, you know, whatever, piss off. But I could say it through these sets of characters, much like, you know, the Family Circus, Calvin and Hobbes, mm-hmm. you know, right? Like, all of these things that I grew up with, these cartoons, these comics that I grew up with, that I grew up loving, they say, you know, you paint what you know.
Right,
know?
Of course, and you so live what you know. You, you do what you know. Exactly. Yeah.
Absolutely. So, you know, that was what I was as a kid. That was who I was as a kid. And, you know, depending on who you talk to, unfortunately, that's who I am as a grown-ass man.
But, cheers.
So I'm going to read something that came from New City, I believe, just to give you guys kind of a rounding out of really this character and how it's touched people. Brantley's iconic character, the flyboy, and his accompanying crew of polycultural homies, all vibrant, active, bruised, and soaring. Here's an incredibly fresh assemblage of makeshift community of young people who traverse emotional territory and urban landscape with hope and heartbreak. Based off the Tuskegee Airmen, Brantley's flyboy is a black comic book superhero in a landscape where heroes are usually white. So I think it really does resonate with a lot of people. And I can barely see because the lights are so bright. But how many people have seen his murals all over the city? There we go. Okay, so people
like
know.
Two, three people.
No, no, no. It's the whole first section for sure. Yeah. Well, so back to Charles. I wanted to ask you. You were saying that you're involved a little bit still with Kickstarter, but I know that you've got another project up your sleeve right now. Tell me about the Center for the Lost Arts, and then I've got lots of questions.
Okay. This is so. I will start by saying this: that this is sort of in the stage that Kickstarter was 8 years ago, right? Early sort of fumbling stages, sort of experimental stage. But this was Center for Lost Arts was a little pop-up that I had produced in July, actually right down the street.
Morgan.
Yeah, at Morgan and Hubbard. The building's going to get torn down next month, which is pretty interesting. I'm actually excited about it.
Oh, you
it's
are?
Cathartic. Yeah, okay. Yeah. It was actually part of the reason we got in there. So anyway, so it was a workshop. So think tools and internet access.
Okay, hold on. Think tools.
Mm.
Equipment.
You have notes.
Yeah. Equipment at the center includes six 3D printers from MakerBot, a soldering iron, three CNC machines, including a ShopBot.
Yeah, that's right.
An X-Carve, a Shapioko.
Shapeoko.
Shapeoko.
That's awesome.
Okay, a Shapeoko, because who knows what that
sculpture.
Is?
Yeah.
Who knows what that is?
Yeah.
A laser cutter, a couple of drill pressers, a drum sander, and a planer jointer.
A lot of stuff. Yeah. So it was, you know, fairly messy space. It was the impetus behind it was about 15 years ago when I was living here in Chicago in another life. I wanted to build a piece of furniture. I, mind you, don't know jack all about making furniture or anything physical because I've been doing this for a long time at that point. And I was looking for a space to do it. I should note that I'm a college dropout, so I don't really work in this kind of like linear fashion of like you learn A to learn B to learn C, and then suddenly somewhere like 15 years later you can actually make something. I wanted to actually make something. I had a thing that I wanted to make. And none of the spaces at the time seemed to allow me to do that. So I did what I had around me. I was sort of being resourceful, and I used my my father-in-law's backyard in Skokie in the middle of December. Anybody, you know, you guys know what Chicago's like in December, right?
Yeah, uh-huh.
It's awesome, right?
Right.
Especially in the backyard when you're trying to work, and not good. It was a disaster, total horrible thing. The thing that I wanted to make never got made. And 15 years later, Kickstarter behind me at that point, I was still thinking about this idea. And I think the other side of the story was in looking at the 7 years of building Kickstarter up to what it is today, and seeing all of the projects that kind of came out from it, and solving one part of the sort of creative journey, which was about getting funding and then putting it out into the ocean. There was another part of the story that's missing and still sort of missing for me, which is like, how do you actually go from getting out of school where you learn a trade or learn some sort of creative, you're just trying to get a sense of where you're going. You're just trying to sort of put your opinion out there. And you're sort of thrown out into the world and you have to go work at Starbucks. No offense, but, and so like, where do you go to still have access to some of the tools that you rattled off and others? And so this thing in July was sort of a very intense experiment or design research project to kind of see how would something like this exist in the real world outside of my brain.
So I'm going to translate that just a little bit, just in case you didn't really follow that. And correct me if I'm wrong, because I was in Alaska and I didn't get to go to it when it was a pop-up.
Where in Alaska?
I was in...
usually in Alaska in July, so...
I was in Alaska in July, yes. Denali, Talkeetna.
Okay. I'm usually in Kenai, fishing with my dad.
Kenai, it's just so beautiful. Yeah. So I didn't get to go to the pop-up. Okay. But it's a space for about 20 artists where they can just make things. It's where they have a workshop to themselves. We maybe even have a picture or two.
That's my feet. She asked for photos. I didn't really know what
to say. But I think we have one or two of a workshop or somebody.
There you go.
So there's a space in a workshop.
Yeah. 20 people.
And then 20 people, but they all have their own cubicles so that they could really just make whatever they wanted to make.
I'll keep describing. So actually, it's the building's sort of similar to this, but like way more dingy. What I mean by that is sort of an open
with
frame
no
building.
Food.
Yeah, no food, actually. Well, actually, so the building, before I took ownership of it for the month, was an old meat packing plant.
Uh-huh.
So there was food in preparation for to become food. Anyway, somebody got the joke. Right. So it was an open frame where you were saying there was like cubicles or areas that artists have to work. There's two things that I'll sort of correct in there in reference to explaining this. One was, I think the open architecture of the space was really important because I think boundaries are inhibiting. And I find the intersection between disciplines really interesting space, right? And so the architecture giving visibility between a painter who, literally there's a woman who is painting on the floor. I don't know why she wanted to do this, but I warned her a number of times what was in there before. She was vegetarian, actually, as well. But she insisted that was part of her thing, so that was cool. And she was doing it literally right next to a table saw, right? And every once in a while, somebody would come in and use the table saw, and she would have to get up. But, you know, in one frame, you have an artist painting, and on the other end of the room, you've got a product designer building a product.
Right.
And I think the intersection between those things is really interesting. So nobody really actually had cubicles. There were stations for machines, and then people would kind of hover around the space. And 20 grew into 60, which grew into about 80 over the course of the month.
Great. I really wanted to ask you about this entire center running for the month, and I want to open this question up to the two of you as well, so feel free to chime in your own disciplines.
It smells good.
What did it teach you about creativity and how people create? And I'll give you, the reason I'm asking this question is because when I was going to school, I thought creativity is the act of creating something.
Yeah.
And now that I'm older and technology has changed life, et cetera, I no longer really think this. I think creativity is the freedom to hear yourself think, because I can't get even to the creative ideas anymore because there's so much at me all the time.
Mm.
So I think there's a step before actually creating, and that's the step of having a space to sort of hear yourself.
Yeah, and
reflection.
Totally.
Yeah.
So, and there was actually can we go back?
Can we go back to
one? So that Becca. You know, there's a little bit of this. Actually, I love this scene. I took this photograph, but I love it. Is it good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I love this because this was the first thing I saw in the morning. This table that 4 or 5, 6 of us built, right? And there was a number of them like this in the space. And so there was this serenity that I'm going for the space that, it sort of removes yourself from the cacophony of life. But at the same time, at a busy point in the day, this whole space could be completely filled with stuff.
Uh-huh.
So you do end up with that cacophony. But I think there is this, I think the attitude for me was, I think that it goes to the coffee shop comment, the Starbucks comment, which was, at some point you do need to pay your bills, right? Like there's a pragmatism to life, but I think once you get sort of sucked into the rat race of the pragmatism of life, you lose that fun heyday where you let go,
yes,
right? And so you need some space to let go And so I think for me and what I was trying to engender for those who I invited into the space was a space that they can kind of let go and
let
be themselves. But it's important to still transact the idea into an object. That is ultimately the
goal. Everyone
had
to do that.
That's creativity, right?
Right, like, the act of creating, yeah. Yes. Yeah. I'm curious, you've photographed so many creative people over your lifetime and their lifetimes. I'm wondering what being an observer, because that's really what a photographer is, what has it taught you about creativity and how people create?
Well, I can only answer in that, I mean, one interesting thing is that obviously you talk about the famous people who maybe weren't so famous when I took a photograph.
Right, yes,
but
sure.
But they might have been my friends. My way of create was just to get in a car and drive to the Grand Canyon and take incredible pictures of landscape. And that's something, of course, not people, galleries don't particularly want to see a picture of a tree or a landscape necessarily from me, because I'm known as a different kind of photographer. But what you said about reflection and about taking, you know, that space time,
yeah.
Was very important to me. Just walking in the street and the flower seller or the
yes.
woman in the sweet shop. Or,
and being present.
And I'm, because yeah. I travel so much over England and America, and America was a second home to me because my father was in the diplomatic corps in Washington mm. during the Kennedy administration. Mm. And I love America. I was at school here, and so it feels wonderful to be back, by the way. But I think that's the creative, my way of, you know, it's not just about people, although people are terribly important. It was the creative between the spaces. Don't paint the object, paint the space between. And I guess that's what I did to be creative. Is that kind of answer the question?
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
However you want.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
I'm eager to chime in because you also work alone, don't you?
Most. Yes, sadly enough, I'm working.
Oh, alone. It's all right. I'll marry you.
No,
I'd like to
I'm
be
sure
there
you're
for
married.
That.
I don't think that you have to be present to be creative. I think that a part of, especially for me, is creating from a place of the subconscious. You know, just like that freeing. You know, in my process, you know, it's more about seeing sort of what comes out, you know, all the bullshit from today or yesterday, and just kind of attacking the canvas or the paper and not thinking, just kind of going and then stepping back and sort of sizing up what is in front of me.
Interesting.
And sort of assessing and then, you know, changing my direction or going further with, you know, what has already come out.
So
with a lot of my work, I don't know if it's, we have any pictures, but In many series that I do, I'll do sort of a line work behind the actual subject. And, you know, it's sort of not necessarily one continuous line. However, it's just different, you know, fragmented sort of ideas or just places that my mind goes. And, you know, I kind of go until I exhaust myself and then pull back. And it's really interesting, you know, to do that, because a lot of times, like, shit that I didn't even know was there
yeah.
comes out. And, you know, it's almost a way of therapy, too.
But I think that's what Charles is saying, to get to that place where stuff can come out.
Sure.
And it doesn't all have to be the great stuff, and it doesn't have to be the moneymaker stuff. You can go back and edit
sure.
or
yeah.
pull back, or but you at least are getting that free-flowing going.
Mm. Mm.
All your years in Kickstarter, did you ever have a favorite Kickstarter project?
The unfair question.
I know.
Yeah. There's a. I mean, there's different stories for different ones. You want a story for a project? Is that what you're?
Well, if you'd like to give
yeah.
one.
I mean, you know, so.
Nashville.
Art phone. Which one?
Art phone.
I don't know that one. You want you? Is it your?
Gross Nashville in history. Art phone.
There you go. I don't know that one.
I don't know that
but
one.
But that
either.
Sounds like an awesome project.
Yeah.
You know, so I think I'll think back to like when we first launched, right? And when we had first launched, you know, I think it was A, interesting to see anybody use it.
Sure.
Right?
Thrilling, I bet.
Yeah. And at that time, this was like April 28th, 2009 is the day that we launched. I don't remember what exact time, but that was the date. And, you know, the first couple of weeks or first couple of months, it was just friends, right? People that we had been talking about for months or years. They were like, hey, we finally launched that thing. It's like, oh yeah, so you know, life moved on, right? So I've not, you know, that project that I talked
it's
about,
over, right?
Totally done. Anyway, but you know, there was a moment. And I remember the conversations with friends of mine who wanted to release a record and they wanted to raise $1,500. And I was like, oh man, $1,500, like that's gonna be tough, man, you know? Now it's a little different story, but you know, those were big projects at the time, like a couple hundred dollars, a couple thousand dollars, and then it started steamrolling. There was this one project though, probably about 3 months in, that this woman out of Athens, Georgia, she was a design student that was also a singer and songwriter, and she had launched her campaign on, a Thursday morning, which I guess is not a thing anymore. I don't know, Thursday is not popular, but
okay.
Launched it on a Thursday morning. She wanted to raise $2,000. No big deal, right? That's kind of a thing, kind of within our limits. And before we went to bed, $2,000 was done, like within a day.
Oh, that's good.
And we're like, what's going on here? By the time we woke up the next day, it had grown, and we didn't know this person. And so it was one of the first people that had a viral, right? She raised $2,000 in like 8 hours,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
It was like, whoa, shit's on fire. And we didn't know this person. Because at those days, not only did we, it was heavily curated. Like, you really needed to know us to get onto the platform. And she went on to raise like $7,500, $7,700 and some odd dollars.
Wow.
You know, I think there was what's special to me about it was it was the first time it sort of stepped out of our circle of friends or our boundaries. It taught us a lot about how to run a really great campaign, how to be engaging with your audience, which was really fascinating. I mean, I'd say that a lot of people can still learn from that campaign.
I have somebody.
Allison Weiss was her name. So I'll give you that.
I have somebody who fits all of that.
Okay, yeah.
So she's running a very engaging campaign. It is one of my favorite Kickstarter campaigns. And she, you don't really know
her.
Is
she here?
She might be here. She might be here, and she might be willing to perform, and she might be able to tell us about her Kickstarter campaign. Please welcome the ever, ever talented Tiffany Monique.
Ah.
Okay, so I'll just say, Tiffany is going for $30,000 so that she can put, and you just correct me if I'm wrong and just jump in at any time, so that she can put out her first CD that would really be, it's not your first CD because you have
it's
many
CDs.
It's not
my first CD.
You tell it.
It's my first solo CD as a jazz artist. So I put out three other discs before in a duo setting. So this is my first solo CD. It's the first CD that I'm working with a producer who also happens to be Grammy Award winning.
Woo.
And some really incredible musicians. So it's an exciting time. And I'm 65% funded, and I've got 10 days to go.
Right. September 24th is her deadline date.
That's correct.
So if everybody wants to get... Well, you listen to her sing, and then you will be convinced. And I won't even have to tell you, because really, it's something so special. And so
Thank
I
you.
Really want it to happen
Thank
for you.
You.
But Tiffany Monique, everybody. Say, hey, yeah.
cut me into two. And with all your magic, I disappear from you. And I can't get over. Can't get over you, no, no. So I call it magic. Such a precious jewel. It's true. I don't know. I don't want anybody else but you. I don't want anybody else. I want to fall, yes. I want to fall so hard.
Ben Lewis on piano.
Mr. Ben Lewis.
Thank you.
I believe that there's information on everybody's plate. So if you want to find out more about her, her Kickstarter campaign is on, you give it to everybody on their plate.
Yes.
So everybody has it, because I know the Kickstarter campaign is a long link. But yes. And there's also, right as you exit here tonight, there'll be people who can answer questions for you. And the next person who gets this tweet, because we have a tweet now for Charles, is going to win 3 CDs, I think, from
that
you.
That is correct.
Right? They're winning 3 CDs by Tiffany Monique. So I have a tweet now for
but
Charles.
But only if I answer correctly?
No, there's no pressure on you. There's no pressure on you. Okay. Allie, what have we got, and from whom for Charles?
From The Elastic MTG. How do you imagine the future of crowdsourcing?
Wait, what?
How do you imagine what now?
The future of crowdsourcing.
The future of crowdsourcing.
Oh, this is going to be a horrible... I don't think about it.
You don't think about it.
Done.
That's your answer. You get three Tiffany Monique CDs because that? Crowdsourcing might be done. We're not
crowdfunding.
Sure.
Crowdsourcing, I have no opinion. Yeah.
Well, okay. Thank you, that person. That's your question. That's it.
Cool. You mean it's too late to ask you know, the slightly unfinished documentary up there?
That's
right. Because Corinthia's working on a documentary. That's a new Kickstarter campaign. Yeah. Well, thank you, Tiffany
Monique.
You.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being here. So, I wanted to ask you, was it as glorious as it seemed to be in that time? Doesn't even sound like you really appreciated it then.
It's much more glorious to be here with you.
That sounds wonderful.
You. Yeah, I mean, you're in the present, aren't
Shalom.
You?
Yes.
You should always
yes.
be in the present.
Yes, of course. You
know, yes, of course. But sometimes it's like you look back and you think, was that really me? Hmm. Was I really there?
Why do you say that?
Well, because I guess a lot of my generation shared those times too. It's not just me.
Right, of course.
I just happened to take a picture or two.
Yes.
But, many, many, many people. people created that time.
Yes.
Thousands and millions, perhaps. And it was also a time, you know, many things of sadness were happening.
Sure.
The 60s, Kennedy and Martin Luther King. And there were great strivings for things.
Sure.
My little bit of it was perhaps a little bit hedonistic even, you know, just sort of lovely times, a moment in time.
I think that's one of the reasons that it's so appealing. It looks hedonistic. And I don't find that we're in a very hedonistic time, personally. Because, you know, people are linked constantly to this information all the time. And so I don't know what you guys think about that, but I don't think this is a very hedonistic time.
No, I think it's a very, very cataclysmic, difficult time.
People are always watching you. Yeah, you're always sort of on your best.
There's too much
Facebook
information that we
stuff,
don't need, too.
Yes,
you
right.
Know, most, I mean, if you think about 200 years ago, the most you ever knew was the face of the Queen on a stamp or a coin.
Yeah.
Right.
You know,
and now,
or if they happened to take a coach through your village or something. But now we know everybody and everything and every bit
sure,
of information.
There's something we haven't discovered. But what I'm curious about is we're being very reflective of 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And what are we going to look at this period as,
exactly.
Right? Like, how's the pendulum swing?
Absolutely.
Right? Like,
absolutely.
Are we going to become much more protective in 30 or 40 years because we're so transparent now? Or have we really hit a point of transparency? Or is it just simply this?
I agree.
Right?
I agree. Because I wonder sometimes if the next generation will know really what privacy means. What, not being open, not having everything looked at.
They'll have their own definition of it.
They will.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I don't think they know it now. You ask about the next generation, but I don't think this generation knows what privacy means. And I don't. And because there's no privacy, to me, there's no truth. Everyone is living so openly that they aren't really being themselves because they know they're being watched and photographed. And so without privacy, you don't really have truth, I feel. I don't know.
I think, you know, there was something that one of you had said about kind of stopping, maybe it was a Grand Canyon description, right? You sort of stop and appreciate this one moment that we're in, and I think about like my own use of Instagram, right?
Yes.
And in this, like, oh, I see something, I'm gonna stop and share that moment with people.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, I'm not, my wife, who's out there somewhere, would probably shun me for not taking enough pictures of us, but most of my photographs are of objects. Right, they're sort of
your feet.
They have my feet, apparently, or tables and tools, and so there are these. For me, it's these moments that reflect something that I'm thinking in my head, or a moment that stops me in my tracks and makes me think maybe it is my feet.
Yes.
Well, I'd like to also add to that was when I used to do camping trips with my parents across America. One of the most, I had a box brownie in those days, you know, like everybody else.
Yeah.
But we'd stop in some glorious place, the Grand Canyon, say, or Monument Valley, and we'd pitch our tent, and then somebody would roll up next to us in an Apache caravan or whatever they were, and there'd be a little sign put there by Kodak that said, opportunity photograph number 3. And there was a whole, this is somebody, anybody old enough here like me to remember this. And people would get out of the caravan, almost queue to take a picture from that spot, then get back into the caravan and watch TV. I can remember it like it was yesterday.
Wow.
And that was inspiring, I mean, in the wrong way, and to make me think, you've got to go out from those, you know, exactly. So we haven't really changed.
No.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
To me, that's
weird.
Fascinating. Because I think of us, don't you guys think of us as having changed so much, particularly within the last 10 years, but maybe not so much.
We're still fascinated with these photographs,
right?
She just happened to have access to these people and photographing the things around you. Yeah,
I mean, and be trusted, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, my grandmother always said, stop making an exhibition of yourself, as I did another exhibition. You know, you're only allowed to be in the papers 3 times. Once when you're born, once when you get married, and once when you die, and that's it. And you get that much. And you made 5 exhibitions of yourself already, and then she died, luckily. Not for me, because I loved her, but, you know. So, you know, it's a mindset, too.
Yeah.
And coming from that British background, perhaps, was, you know,
reticence, you know, you're
it sounded a lot like, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, Charles was actually born in Britain.
A very, very short period of my life, but yeah. I can understand a little bit, yeah.
And you said that you had a nice story for us about Prince Charles and a dinner party.
She doesn't forget anything. only because we were connecting to the dinner party earlier on when we were backstage. And I, in my single years, was invited to a dinner party in a private home in England, in London, and told to be, you know, there absolutely on time at 7 o'clock. Because the dinner party was for Prince Charles, who at that time was not married to Diana. He'd just come back from a Australian tour. And he wanted to meet Barry Humphries. And I knew Barry Humphries and his then wife. And there were seven of us, literally round a table like this. And we were told, be there at seven, and you can't, you must be there before he arrives, and you must leave after he leaves. You know, that's the etiquette. And so we all got there on time, and he finally arrived, and he was charming, and he was quite young, I guess, in, I can't remember, he would have been 30, before he married Diana, a couple of years before. And we had a very jolly dinner, and he really wanted to meet Barry Humphries, so there's lots of, anybody know who Barry Humphries is? Edna Everidge, you know, the great comedian in England. Very funny, great dinner, very relaxed. And our host knew that Prince Charles had to leave at 11 because he was going up to Scotland to join his mother in Balmoral by train. And so he started getting a bit edgy around 11 o'clock, seeing the time, and Prince Charles was enjoying himself and having a great time and had his hand on my knee. Nothing ever came of it. And, and we had a really... He was like a jolly schoolboy, you know, like very funny sort of jokes. And finally, our host at 11:30 said, sir, I'm terribly sorry to disturb you, sir, but I really have to go. You know, you've got to catch your train. And he so sweetly said, well, actually, it waits for me. And none of us had thought, this is the royal train. Yeah, it waits for him, and it goes when he wants to go. And we were like, we felt so stupid.
I have a great tweet for Corinthia. Allie, what does somebody want to ask her?
It's actually a card.
A card.
From Chuck Stepner. Who are your favorite people to photograph?
Who my favorite?
People to photograph. People to,
in terms of one person or sort of types of people or just...
Him.
Yes, Chuck wants Chuck to know your favorite subject to photograph.
Subject. Women, I think.
Why?
Because I'm one and I hope. Vulnerability, you know, trying to reach the heart of a person. I mean, I have a photograph of Linda Ronstadt and Mick Jagger.
Yes, I think we have it here.
Do you? Oh, they're coming up. There we are.
I love that photograph.
Yeah.
I love that.
That has had a lot going on at the time, some of which I can't possibly reveal tonight. But she was so sweet and such a lovely person, is such a lovely person. And he'd been a bit naughty.
Mick?
Yes. He'd been two-timing certain people. We won't go there.
Okay.
And
we'll have to get you more wine. It'd be fun to go there.
But I love that look. I love the fact that he looks so naughty and she looks so dreamy and
happy.
Yes,
she looks so dreamy.
Adorable,
there.
You know.
Yes.
And he's looking at me. Guess why?
So the person who, Chuck, who asked that question, you are winning $50 to Taos Authentic. Okay,
wow.
I talk to people. It's time to participate. And a signed catalog of Corinthia's work. So you get all these pictures in the catalog, which is really great. Lucky Chuck. Lucky Chuck. Well, so Hebrew, I wanted to ask you, because so very few artists are as successful as you are. And... Oh, yes. I mean, you exhibit in Geneva, you were telling me, in London. You represent yourself here in the United States, which I think is also an incredible feat. You have so many murals up in the city of Chicago, and you have public works. How does success change you?
And I guess I could ask the same thing about fame, too, if you want to jump in. I mean, how does this change you? Because, you know, once you're successful, are you stuck? And then, you know, what if you ever wanted to change out of Flyboy? I don't know.
Well, I mean, I do other work besides that. But
sure.
I think that it's one of those things. It's kind of like it's a little bit of an addiction, right? You know, you start to, you know, you're dealing with these things and these ideas that you've had forever. And then people are gravitating towards them. And you're starting to see that, you know, not only you connect with this idea or these ideas, and you want to now, you've completed that idea, you've completed this one, so now you want to give more and more and more and more. So, you know, in that way, I'm very much a workaholic because I have so much, I have a very large head. So I have a lot going on up there all the time. So, you know, just trying to get as much out as I can before I go, you know.
Well, so, you know, I really wanted to wait for Chef, but I think maybe we'll surprise Chef and we'll ask him this question as well when he comes out. But I'll ask you, you love what you do, is that true?
100%.
Okay, does loving what you do make you better in bed? And the reason I ask this question, this is a God's honest, truthful question. Because, no, this is a truthful question, because loving what you do, loving what you do, also...
Only if he's in bed alone. I mean, I don't know, you're asking him, like there you go.
The question's coming to you too,
back.
Mister.
I don't know. Yeah.
It means a very focused life.
Sure.
It means a very, I don't want to say self-obsessed life, but when you're going it alone, when you're an artist, well, okay.
Which way are we going alone?
He's taking us to another place. Yeah. But you know, when you're really just focused on your ideas and you really want to see this thing finished and, you know, you really want to create this and it's not a 9-to-5 job.
We don't grow up, so, yeah.
Great. It's hard to be a partner.
Sure.
So, I mean, in a way, I wonder, but I always say, like, so it's a natural question. People say, oh, yes, I love what I do. Oh, yes, it makes me so happy. But really, it can, when you're so in love with your job, it's hard to be there for other people.
Sure. But I think if we're talking about in bed, I think
we are.
It's loving who you do is what makes you good at that, you know? I think that that's a good choice.
Good.
Way to keep your calm in the pressured situation. Yeah. I hope people are tweeting that out right now. Yes, absolutely. I think it's both. It's loving who you're with, and it's loving yourself.
But it's also, you know, I mean, I'm fortunate enough where my wife, I mean, we've been together for 7 years. She finally gets it, like, okay, well, I kind of got to do this if you want this, and you know,
it's a trade-off.
It definitely is, but you know, I mean, you find that balance, and I think that we've definitely found ours, and you know, she's very, very supportive in what I do, and you know, aside from actually painting the paintings for me, she helps in any way she possibly can.
I'm sure. So. Yes, I'm sure. And that's why it works, because so many artists don't survive the relationship.
Sure.
Because, it's you're focused on yourself a lot, and it's a tricky situation. And maybe you saw that in the Center for Lost Arts as well. Yeah. Certainly you saw it over the years.
That was only a month, so.
Yes, that would be a short relationship. But, I mean, how many relationships have you photographed sort of when they were a couple and then separate over the years? I mean, it takes its toll.
Yeah, well, Carly, Simon, James Taylor were a famous couple, weren't they, in
yes.
the 70s? And Carly's remained a great friend to this day. But it's still very much in her mind, all that. Yeah, of course. And, you know, you love someone, you love them probably for the rest of your life and a part of them, don't you? I think, you know, I coined a phrase a while ago that we're all a little bit glamour junkies, you know. There is this thing that rubs off from being around. I was luckily enough around pretty well-known people because of my father being a diplomat. And so I had sort of, you know, they had Winston Churchill to dinner, that kind of thing. And so it's people, you know. I was brought up that you are, people are the same whatever they do. So I was lucky like that. But going back to that, I think, you know, I don't envy people who are very, very well, very famous. It's not an easy job. It's a terrifying.
I think it is a terrifying
and
job.
And what I have noticed is that they're very clever at totally being invisible when they want to be. So you can walk down the street with certain people and you think, I don't know, they've got a way of shuffling.
Oh, yes, they've got that. Yes, yes,
whatever.
Yes. No makeup.
And then they suddenly snap into, that's me, you know. And there's a look, and you're there, and you go, wow, you know, that's the. So that's why they're charismatic people and talented and extraordinary.
Yeah.
But they're not saints.
Right, no, well, if there's a story there. Well, it's amazing how your life has worked out, because didn't you room with Helen Mirren?
Oh, I've just stayed with Helen in Italy, actually, celebrating her, I can't say it, but it's a birthday. It's a big one. And she's gorgeous, wonderful, dear friend, yes, yeah, yeah.
But, she seems like a lovely person.
But I also have a lot of friends who aren't well-known. I just have to quickly say that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it sounds like I'm not kind of junkie. Yeah.
Perception versus reality. Yeah.
Right, that you don't only have one kind of friend.
Yeah,
yes.
No, exactly. Wonderful person, yeah, obviously brilliant, as she does. But she's a good example of someone who stays with her feet on the ground, and intelligent people do that. Intelligent people who understand they switch into that, their work role, and then they can be. You know, nobody wants to have an unhappy life, and you have an unhappy life if you're only famous. It's all you do.
Yes.
You know. And look at all the casualties.
Yes. Yeah. I'm going to switch and do a little bit of what you just said. Switch into my work life. We're going to hear from our sponsors and be right back. 90 seconds from now, we'll be right back.
The Talbot Hotel. More than just a Chicago Gold Coast hotel, the Talbot Hotel is a full-service boutique hotel offering the charm of a gracious bygone era coupled with all of today's modern conveniences.
Voss, artesian water from Norway. Splendidly still, or luxuriously sparkling. Voss, artesian water from Norway.
I got to know Staub through Alain Ducasse. Getting one for the first time and then cooking with it was a wow moment for me. What sets it apart, the construction and durability of it, the craftsmanship that goes into it, the history that goes into it. I mean, it goes back to Paul Bocuse. It's like the Mercedes-Benz of cookware for me almost.
And you talk about these other projects, and I wonder, what do you want more of? I'll give you an example. So Jim DeRogatis was on this show from Sound Opinions.
Yeah.
And of course everybody says, what do you want more of? What are next steps for you? And of course everybody says, I'm so grateful. I feel so blessed and honored to have what I have already. Okay, I'm sure that's true. But Jim was really honest when he answered this, and he said, you know, I've always had the number 120 in my mind. We're in 108 markets around the United States for Sound Opinions. I want 120. And I wonder if you have any of those desires, what do you want more of?
Oh, let's see, where can we start? You know, world knows.
world peace.
No, I mean, you know, I want that. I'm a very untraditional artist. You know, I started within graffiti culture.
Right.
I started, you know, merging that to street art, and then, you know, sort of learning the over-the-shoulder method, like following artists from New York and L.A. and kind of bugging the shit out of them to where they would allow me to be in their studio for a little while to kind of steal from their practice. So I didn't go to school for it. I didn't do, you know, studio studies and, you know, didn't get my MFA and sort of those things that you're supposed to do, you know, in order to take it to that next step. But, you know, it's very important for me that the work is taken as serious as I take it, you know. And though there is, you know, a lighthearted side to it, there's a whimsical nature to it, it still has a very serious sort of subtext in a lot of it. And, you know, I want that to be seen, and I want that to become sort of legacy in a way where the Brantley name can exist as, you know, or in conversation with
so many others, you know. I mean, even in Chicago, the Patchkeys, the Kerry James Marshalls, you know, the Astor Gates. So being in that audience, you know, being a part of that conversation is what I want more of.
Let's take a peek and see exactly how he creates. We've got a short video here of how he makes his murals, and it's really fun to watch. Yes, we have a video of you. So he's not getting a cupcake. So if you change your mind tonight, we have more cupcakes for you if you need
them. My daughter will gladly take your cupcake.
Is your daughter here tonight?
No.
Oh, too bad. Too bad.
What time is it? It's probably bedtime.
It's probably bedtime. It is, yes. Yeah. It's time for a tweet is what time it is. And we now have a question for Hebrew. So, Allie, what do we got?
From Kelly McMahon, how has Chicago impacted your art?
Kelly. $50 for you at Tess Authentic. Just saying. And a Hebrew Brantley t-shirt.
All right. You're living now, Kelly. Living now.
So how has Chicago influenced your art?
Chicago's me. You know, I grew up here. I'm a Southside kid. So obviously I put a lot of my experience into what I do. So, you know, and my experience is, you know, Chicago in all facets, you know, the lakefront, that embrace that you get there, the skyline, you know, the people, the food, most importantly, the food. But it's just a part of my DNA. So, you know, it definitely just kind of comes out in what you see in Chicago. So, sidebar, I don't know where the hell you guys got that video from. That's hilarious because I've never seen that video. That was Seattle. About, I think, maybe 2 years ago, and I was in the absolute worst pain I've ever been in my entire life while painting that. I slipped, so where you saw me shutting the gate, it was, it's downtown Seattle, and it was a site they were supposed to be building on, and it was all rocks, all gravel, it was absolutely nothing in the structure. So I was standing the first day that I got there, and, you know, it was kind of like on this incline, and the entire part of where I was standing gave out.
Oh.
And so I went all the way down to the bottom of like this quarry, just down the rocks. And like, I don't know what part of my back just said, you know what?
We're not doing this anymore.
I'm taking a day off, I'm taking a break. So I was definitely, you know, Seattle's a place where you can, you know, it's 420 friendly. So that was my medication while I was in Seattle. So.
Coming our way.
Hey, it's a dinner party, all right?
We've got some more medication coming our way because we're going to see We're going to see what Chef has been making in the kitchen for our entree, which we already scrunched up, but here comes Chef soon.
Welcome back to the dinner party with Elizabeth Alfano. I'm Michael Taus from Taus Authentic Food and Drink. Now we're going to be doing our wonderful entree. I have a flat iron steak, which I'm a big fan of. I love the richness, the meatiness of it. I'm going to really do a nice seasoning on here with our salt, just making it evenly across the steak. Also, I'm going to hit it with a little bit of extra virgin olive oil, just so it doesn't stick to the grill. Also, I have this great chimichurri. We're just going to cover the whole thing with this. Listen to that beautiful sizzle. Yeah, the big thing about keeping it hot is also like with fish, you don't want it to stick. if they have the proper temperature. We also oil the pan down properly so that we have a nice kind of almost nonstick surface. While our steak is heating up, we're just gonna take these wonderful potatoes, fingerlings, which we roast in duck fat. Now I'm gonna put them in the oven. See, it's grilling nice. I'm gonna just give it a quick turn. And having a nice hot sear keeps all the juices in. So we're gonna grab that steak. We're just gonna put it here on a sizzle platter, let it rest just for a few seconds. It takes the redness in the middle and kind of dissipates it through the whole piece of meat. So it looks a little bit cooked a little bit more evenly. So now we're gonna put our wonderful salad together. So we have that fresh fennel, which is one of my favorite things in the world. I love that anise flavor. We're gonna grab some of that apple. We're gonna take some of the French breakfast radish, throw it in there. And then we're also gonna take some of the jardiniere, throw a little jardiniere in there, and we're gonna mix this all up. It's really like a super refreshing salad. The contrast of that rich meat really brings it together, so. We are going to take our potatoes. I'm gonna lay them down almost like a little bed. Great, so we've accomplished that. So now we're gonna take our steak. I'm gonna cut this in a nice bias. So I'm gonna lay this down across the top. We have that steak on the plate, beautifully fanned out. So now we're gonna take some of that wonderful salad, place it on top. Then I like to just take a little bit more of that white balsamic. I just like to just juice this up a little bit. And this incredible smoked paprika. Now there we go. And I have a grilled flat iron steak with chimichurri spice, roasted fingerling potatoes, a little bit of apple, fennel, and jardiniere salad. Thank you for joining us at the dinner party with Elizabeth Alfano. I'm Michael Taus from Taus Authentic Food and Drink, 1846 West Division. Hopefully you can come to the restaurant and experience this wonderful food that we do like we did this evening. Enjoy.
Much. I wanted to ask you a question that I had thrown out to people sort of, you know, not really expecting a response, but I think it's a real question.
We're going back to the same question.
We're not.
How are you in bed?
You can answer that if
you like. My mic's off.
Yeah. Okay, I'll give you the, I'll ease in gently. I'll give you the food question first. This is always the time of the show when we lose people because they've got a little bit of a sugar high. So like everyone's got their cupcake at this point. I wanted to ask you, with the change of how people dine and everyone is taking pictures of their food all the time, do you get the sense that people care less about the food and more about being at the place or being next to the food?
You know, I think it's there's a fascinating article that was out this year that this company, this restaurant in New York that's been in business 30 years, has some complaints that the food was taking longer than normal. So they spent $25,000 with the company to record and look at all their tapes and figure it out. It was coming out the same amount. It was just people were taking pictures and on their phone, wasting time too much.
Yeah.
And it was the same amount of time, but I think society has changed because everybody's worried about their phone and, you know, not looking at each other, and it's not like an experience.
Yeah.
But I think, people have learned more about food. People are more inspired. I do a lot of cooking classes throughout the years, and I have some incredible students who are like traders or doctors or lawyers, and they want to do food to the next level. And I think I think it's very exciting cooking for people right now because people care so much about what's going into it.
Well, I'm wondering, how has that changed the psyche of the chef? Because it used to be chefs were behind. You'd never see them. They were in the kitchen. It was the maitre d', the guy at the front of the house. He was the guy to know. Now it's the chef from the back of the house who's coming out front. And I'm wondering how all this sort of picture taking, like I went to the restaurant Mexique, and it was all about taking pictures with Carlos, the chef, who was on Top Chef at the time. So I'm wondering how this has changed the psyche of the chef. Not just that the chefs are interested in fame, but, and maybe they're interested in fame, some chefs are interested in fame, but how does that change their connection to the food?
But you know, I think being a restaurateur and a chef is a much different thing than just being a chef.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because I feel that I'm running a business. I have to think about every aspect from the front and back door. And
But also, I never leave the restaurant, so it's kind of nice talking to people.
Yes.
It's kind of my entertainment for the evening. And but I also think connecting with them, you know, makes them want to come back. But I think it's always been like that. In 1986, I went to apply at a place called La Tita de Paris, Pierre Polon. At the time, he was the hottest chef in Chicago. Yeah. And I walked in there, and I was 18 years old, and I said, please, I would love to work here. And he goes, I have a stack of resumes this high. Why would I hire you? I go, I'm free. He goes, you start tomorrow. And then after 2 weeks, he paid me a little bit. But
Sweet. But
that was the thing. He was the first chef I ever met that worked a table. Like, he was charming and amazing. And he would tell incredible little stories about where the food came from or why that dish was inspired. And he was in France. But I think that's part of the whole experience. It's or about the wine or about whatever. You know, it's not just one aspect in a restaurant that makes it great. It's a soul. I think when you walk into a restaurant, you feel that soul of the restaurant. Because I think some places people come just to fill their stomach, but some places they go to have an experience. It doesn't have to be an expensive experience.
Right, right.
Because I worked at a place called Patina, and the chef's name was Joachim Splishow, and he was an incredible chef. And he was one of the few chefs like that invented so many things, and no one really knew that he was the one who invented it, and everybody copied him because he didn't care. He just wanted to make money. But he was all about the total experience, you know, teaching all of us why, you know, this costs this much, this costs that,
yeah. This
is why this happened, and it was really interesting. Other than just learning how to cook, he taught us about business.
So I think this is fascinating, and I want to ask all of you this. I'm going to start with Hebrew because I think he does such an incredible job. It's so rare that you see an artist who's representing themselves, and you actually have something called Hebrew Brand. Mm-hmm. Playing off your name, which is Hebrew Brantley. So sure. you're trying to make the brand of Hebrew Brantley.
Well,
help me with this.
You know, looking at artists, I'll use Andy Warhol, for example. Warhol's work was sort of almost bastardized after he died. You
right.
know, it was licensed. Mm-hmm. It was magnets. It was coasters. It was all these things. But he didn't necessarily control that. And I think that, you know, a part of what I do in my business model is always having that power, or taking that power back as the creative. And, you know, there are things that, I mean, I love, you know, just in those few things that I named, even shower curtains, carpet, you know, small rugs or stuffed animals. And these are things that, you know, I would love to create, you know, as far as forms of merchandising, but I want to create them. I don't want to be gone and then have somebody say, you know, and sort of repurposing my work giving it out. You know, I want to be the one to do that first.
And where did you get this sense of business? I mean, it's just an incredible combination that you have, the talent and the business mind. And same for Chef, the talent and the business mind to run the business. It's incredible.
I'm Southside Chicago kid. I'm a hustler.
That's great. That's great. So it's street smarts that brings you to this.
I mean, a little bit of street smarts and then just a little, you know, it's looking at my friends. I mean, I grew up in a family full of athletes with my cousins, it was sort of a guarantee where they were going to be after a certain point in their lives, you know, financially speaking.
Right.
And for me, you know, I never really, you know, I was tall, I could play basketball, but I didn't appreciate it and love it as much as they did. And, you know, so it was like, I had to figure it out, and I had to figure it out fast. So, you know, how do I make that work? And my father used to always just preach to me that, you know, you were given a gift, so you need to use it, you know, don't squander it. And so, you know, kind of work the angles.
Chef, is it the same for you? You feel like you were given a gift, and so you could just make the rest work out?
You know, my father is an entrepreneur. He had a printing company when I was a little kid, and he's a frustrated chef. He loves cooking. So on the side, he would like have a, you know, parties with friends and do gourmet catering, and it's a kind of a hobby. But you know, when I was 10 years old, my dad being a printer, I love making money. So I had a lawn service, and I drew out some little brochures. My dad printed 100. I went around the neighborhood. I had 50 lawns a week, and I did that for like 4 years. Saved my money, invested it. You know, and
what?
But it also was a different time when I opened my first restaurant at 25 years old in Elmhurst. I went to a bank that a guy that my dad knew, who knew my career and knew how hard I worked. I walked in there and said, I have $150,000. I need 160 more. And we talked about the concept, what was going on. So I put the money in his bank. He gave me another 160. I signed my name. I walked out.
Wow.
I opened my first restaurant. But it was a different time when someone had the gumption. Mm-hmm. A
right.
banker was allowed to invest in you. Mm-hmm. And I think that's such an interesting thing. Like, getting you have that great idea, but you just need that luck, or you need that person to believe in you.
You need Kickstarter.
I know. That's what I was just going to say. But that's the thing. Like, that little oomph, that little thing that gets you started is when someone believes in you. And I think it goes back to these kids in Washburn in the back. You know, that's what the Trier Project's about. I was very lucky to have some incredible teachers believe in me. You know, you have that one teacher, that one person, that one mentor, just one person that believes in you, just to give you that pat on the back and give you that confidence. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an interesting thing, because in being a chef and teaching these young cooks how to become a chef or a leader, you have to build their confidence up. You can't keep it. It's a different world. I came to the world, and there's lots of yelling. Like the Mike Ditka world of chefing.
And Trotter was a yeller, wasn't he?
Yeah, or the Trotter world.
Wasn't Trotter also but see, yelling?
But there's two people that work for him. Either you got it or you didn't.
Mm. I see.
The people who got it, he didn't yell at you really because you're working hard. And I kind of liked him yelling because he made everybody work harder around you. Yeah. And those people lasted 3 months and they're gone.
Okay.
And they said he was a jerk. But I think that's the thing. Any great leader is not going to be liked. Any CEO is not going to be liked because it's a tough job. It's a lonely job when you're the boss.
Yes, it's a lonely job when you're the boss, but it's not lonely when you have a tweet question for you. Allie, what is the question for our chef?
From Jen McMahon, how has Yelp and similar internet sites impacted your restaurant and operations?
Jen, you're getting $50 at Taos Authentic. I'm just saying. I know.
Am I taking the fifth on this?
No. No, we want to hear about Yelp. I know what Yelp's done for restaurants in concept.
My Yelp rep has... called me 13 times in 2 days.
Yeah. Why?
No, I'm just
kidding.
No, because they're very helpful, and you have to learn it. It's a tool, you know. And he's been, they've taught us how to utilize the site for a small fee. You can, put pictures up and get people, drive people to your restaurant. I think it's. I think you have to figure it out. I think you have to take it with a grain of salt, but I think it's a. It's incredible. Their search engine's great.
I didn't make Yelp. Then don't look at me.
But I don't know. I think it's like anything. I think you have to take it with a grain of salt. And I think sometimes it was easier 20 years ago when you could just do your own thing.
Uh-huh, right. And everybody wasn't watching you. We were talking about that while you were in the kitchen, when you could sort of do things without everyone making a comment about it.
But I also think, too, with Facebook and everything else... it was easier for me to focus and be more creative. Because when you're looking at Facebook all the time and, that chef's doing this and this person's doing that, feel that it clouds your mind because you're like, oh my God, that guy just opened another restaurant. I got to do something.
Yes.
I think it's hard sometimes.
Yeah.
And when I opened in 93, it was different. I just was able to go to the farmer's market or get inspired or go to eat at other restaurants. But also, the internet's great because I can Google, Guy Savoy in Paris and see what he's on his next menu and see his photographs.
Yeah.
You know, and get inspired that way.
So it's a double-edged sword.
It's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
We have a tweet for the entire table. A question for all of us. Allie?
From Michelle Ortiz, how do you face and conquer your fears? You all seem so fearless.
How do you face and conquer your fears? What was the last part?
In parentheses, it says, you all seem so fearless.
You all seem so fearless. I'm going to start with you. How do you face your fears?
Well, I have a fear of heights.
And?
I can start with that one. I don't know where this is going to go at all.
Shall I stand up?
Yeah. No,
right.
Not that kind
okay.
of like,
you real
gotta
fear?
Stand, I've got to stand up.
Oh, okay.
And on the table and like the stage. I don't know. I think if I sort of back up and say, like, maybe not fear of when you're going to go do something somewhat crazy, right, that people, most people in the world, including your family, like your father, and don't understand, but you know in your heart of hearts it's true, you look for those that do believe in you, right? And so... my wife, who's somewhere out there, I think believed in me in somewhere, at least I believed that she believed in me. And I just sort of powered through. And I think at another level, when we were talking about the sex question,
yes.
right? And we were talking a little bit about perceptions or there's just things you need to do. And... I'll explain it this way. So when I was first presented with this idea of Kickstarter, my wife and I were living in New York, And I just quit my job and I was starting my own business, my own studio. And when Perry, who's one of the three, two other guys who had started the company with me, the guy who originated the idea of Kickstarter, was sort of rambling through what Kickstarter would be. Again, this is like years before it existed, two and a half years before it existed. I stopped him mid-sentence and I said, I got it. I think I understand what you're talking about. And I think there was something in what Hebrew had described earlier, which was sort of getting lost in your work and just kind of doing. Like, you just need to do. And that moment of realization or that moment of reflection, it sort of, maybe it was two views, reflection and realization, right? Sort of past and future, was that what Perry was talking about was something that I'd been stumbling through for a number of years on some side projects, right? It was this thing that I was working on. And I mean, maybe the answer for me for that question was simply that it was just something I knew I needed to do. It was something I needed to commit myself to, and, you know, brave or whatever the term was that was used. I mean, there was many like dark moments in the two and a half years or so that it took us from when I joined to get out the door, where we just, you know, we thought, should we throw in the towel? Is this a sign? And I think the greatest inspiration for me was those around me, whether it was my partners, my wife, my family around me, maybe my dad in antithesis, I'm going to prove you wrong, I'm going to fucking do this. I'll show you that some random person on the internet will give some random person some money for some random thing. And here we are at a table on a stage. Yeah, I think it's some belief in yourself. And I think that was a, you know, one moment in my life where I just knew I needed to do this.
So when the fear of not doing it is worse than the fear of doing it.
I hadn't even thought about it that hard.
It was just
needed to do this. And there was
no thinking. There was no thinking.
Right? I mean, and I think this is the thing that goes back to what maybe not Hebrew was describing explicitly, but maybe implicitly was just, you're just doing.
Yes.
And it was just an instinct. And it was like, this is the fucking thing.
Yeah.
And it wasn't about fame and it wasn't about, you know, making a lot of money, but it was about something different, which was for me very personal. It was solving a problem in the world that I didn't like the way the world looked, right? And when this idea was sort of put in my lap, it was a little glimmer of the world, the future world, that got me excited. Maybe a little bit about being that kid again, that's the world that I wish I had when I was a kid.
And that just fired you.
Yeah, that's
wonderful.
Yeah.
That feeling of being a kid again. We'll come back to that very shortly. Corinthia, what about for you?
Could I have the Zach question again?
Yes.
I forgot it too, so I stumbled my ass through that one.
How do you face your fears?
Face your fears.
Alcohol.
Oh.
That's me.
That's the 420.
Thank you.
Or the
420.
No, 420.
420, right.
Okay, that's the 420, yeah.
That actually make you fucking paranoid.
Yeah. So. Depending on how far you go, or what you smoke.
Rather like you jump. And as Churchill said, keep buggering on.
Yeah, I like it.
Because what else are you going to do?
Right.
And
what other option is there?
And also I'm curious. What's around the next corner?
Yeah.
If I do this, well, what the hell? What am I going to do? Sit at home and never know whether it would have worked? Or,
right.
I guess there's a bit of that. My father was a I guess was known here as a 5-star general, and he didn't have a choice when he had to go to Korea or Madagascar or Burma, and he got 3 DSOs, which is an English medal, and that's pretty brave, and lived to have me, and I'm grateful for that enormously, and adored him anyway, and my mother, and so I was lucky. I had this extraordinary brave father.
Yeah, when you have a mentor of someone who's very brave and who goes through the world in that way, then you almost want to live up to it too.
Well, you were talking about the fears. There's nights you go, what on earth am I doing?
Yeah.
God, I'm going on the dinner party. Oh God, I'm going to be murdered alive and everyone's going to be horrible and it's going to be awful. This is wonderful.
Yeah.
You have to jump.
Chef, do you feel the same? Are there nights when you just wonder, why am I opening a bar and a restaurant in the same 6 months?
You know, it's interesting. Phil Patel just gave us a review in the Tribune.
Yay.
And I was talking to him on the phone, and he's been reviewing me since I've been 23 years old. Long time. And I said to him on the phone, I go, it's kind of funny. When I was 25, I wasn't afraid of the review coming out. I was just like bright-eyed, bushy-tailed. But now I'm like a little nervous. I'm older. I'm wiser. I'm smarter. And I said to him, I go, Chevy, happy or sad? He goes, well, this is why I say to all the chefs. Have a bottle of bourbon, a bottle of champagne, you're ready either way. I thought that was pretty funny. But, you know, I think the thing is growing up by an amazing
parent. And the 420.
Parent. Yeah. I had amazing parents growing up. My parents never told me I couldn't do anything. They were always, like, great cheerleaders. I have a very tough dad. And it's not tough to me, but tough. Like, he was not afraid of anything. And I felt I played a lot of sports. He was always my coach. He always, you know, he was great with the kids that we should do better every day. It was a different time. You were allowed to be tough with kids. You were allowed to not yell at them, but, you know, just give them a tough time. And, you know, when I was playing baseball, I was like in second grade or something, and I missed a catch and we lost a game and I was devastated. But I was in the yard every day with my dad for 3 weeks, having him whip that ball at me so I could never miss it again. You know, and the dimmest moment I had at that point in second grade made me, you know, it was a life lesson in the sense that if you have a dim moment, you have to work twice as hard, 10 times as hard.
Yes.
You know, and I think my first restaurant at 25 years old, I worked 7 days a week, 100 hours a week. And that was the thing. Like, the harder you work, you can't be scared.
Yeah.
You know?
Michael Jordan says, you know, he's failed 3,000 times, and that's why he's a success. Because you have to do that exercise of picking yourself up. Hebrew, what would you say to being fearless?
I ain't scared of shit. No.
I love that. Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm 6'8", man. I'm afraid of heights. Every day I wake up, I'm like, oh, you know.
Are you really
I'm not standing up.
I'm terrified of heights.
You're terrified of heights.
I just painted a wall on Wabash. It's like a 5-story building.
I've been watching it, yeah.
And you should have seen me out there. I was like holding on to the thing, shaking, trying to keep a straight line. It was a mess. But no, I think, you know, I think you're sort of measured by your failures, you know, as far as for your successes in that way that, you know, sort of being afraid to not do, you
yes.
know, and I wasn't fortunate enough to, I had a very supportive mother, but I wasn't fortunate enough to have that, you know, with both of my parents. And I think that for me, journeying into art was something that, you know, a black kid from the South Side of Chicago, that wasn't a natural career choice. So it wasn't something that, you know, my parents, you know, in totality fully understood. So it was like, all right, well, you know, how are you gonna make money off this? How the hell does this work? Nah. And my stepfather, he was such an asshole. He I love him, got, you know, recipes, but you know, I am afraid of flying, okay? And so he goes, well, you know, instead of this art thing, which is not gonna work, how about I pay for flight school? You become a pilot. I'm like, first of all, I can't fit in the
you
fucking
mean alcohol?
Cockpit. But no, as you can see, the wine is really
alcoholic.
Good.
Yeah.
You're getting better and better.
I told you, it makes for great interviews.
Yeah. But no, I think, you know, just that fear of not doing, not trying, you know, just putting that shit on the line to the point where I think it becomes something that, you know, it's like brushing your teeth. You know, you don't think about it anymore. It's just routine. You know, every day this
putting
is what I have to do.
Putting yourself out there
yes.
becomes
spending
routine.
Those hours
yes.
putting it in and, you know, just, you know, giving it all, putting it on the line.
So we've talked about fear. So that leads me to Chef. Favorite comfort food for each of you. Chef first. But what do you go to when you just want to sort of curl up on a ball?
Is my wife out of town?
She's not watching.
Yeah.
Or maybe she is. Maybe
she's here. I'm just saying, is she out of town when I'm getting it?
Oh, yes. Well, maybe.
See, I will go to Chinatown at 1 o'clock in the morning. And I love Chinese food. It's one of my specialties. I love it. I call this place up, and they know my order. I don't even have to tell them.
My name.
I love it. You know, as a little kid, we went to all these really interesting ethnic restaurants, and I just fell in love with. We were in Hong Kong about a year and a half ago, and I was like, I'm in my glory. 7 days, 3 meals a day.
Just Chinese food.
That's that. And, you know, every so often, White Castle.
White Castle.
Because,
oh,
you know, the same
Slider,
thing.
Right, yeah.
Corinthia, comfort food.
I make a mean bataga.
I mean, what now?
You don't know what bataga is, do you?
Do you guys know what bataga is?
Bataga, anyone here know what bataga is? It's dried mullet roe. And it comes from Sardinia and Puglia and certain parts of Italy. And it comes in a kind of vacuum packed, you know, bataga. And of course you do. And you take it out, you grate it, and you make spaghetti, and you grate the soap, and you mix it with butter, and it's so delicious. And all my friends think I'm a master chef, and it took 10 seconds.
So you make this, you say that you make it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
You're gonna make it for me, because I have no idea what you're talking about.
Can
okay.
we get some in Chicago?
Sure.
I'm gonna look this up.
Done, tomorrow.
Comfort food.
There we go.
Favorite comfort food.
Oh, mine?
Food.
Mine is a Korean dish called Daengjang Jjigae.
A mini potato.
Well, so you guys know miso soup, right?
Yeah. Sure.
So it's like a more intense version of, way more pungent, way more offensive version of miso soup and spicy. I think when I'm sick, when I'm, I don't know, stressed out or tired, that's what I usually
end up going for.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
You're such a healthy eater.
That's incredible.
I wouldn't say it's healthy, actually. So it sounds healthy, but it's probably full of sodium.
Sure. Yeah. What about you?
I'm not nearly as fancy as everybody here.
Me neither.
Trust me, there's nothing fancy about Daengjang Jjigae.
But it sounds fancy.
It sounds super fancy.
It smells like feet.
My cookies, that's not fancy. Yeah. Fucking cookies. Oh, yeah.
You go cookies.
Famous Amos cookies. But I can't eat them anymore because the no-gluten thing, Famous doesn't. But I found these cookies, I think it's called Pamela's. The brand Mariano's has them, and they're drugs. They're really drugs.
Sweet.
Like,
sugar is a drug.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
It's serious.
So my go-to junk food is always frosting, but my comfort just straight frosting.
Yes.
Just like I'll like hockey hip check a 7-year-old so that I can get his birthday cake. I'm fierce about frosting, but if I go to comfort food, it's always pizza. So very boring. But pizza
no,
come on,
yeah,
the
hell
pizzas.
Yeah.
Yes, always.
Yeah. So it's a yeah yeah.
We I challenge
about,
you.
Yeah, yeah, we were talking about pizza earlier before backstage where you guys couldn't hear us.
Yeah.
Pizza's a thing. Ice cream's a thing.
Sure.
Like,
sure.
How my wife finds like it in the morning like a pint of ice cream in the garbage because
I guess you did
somebody
a pint.
Attacked the shit out of it the night
somebody.
Before.
We don't know who.
Watching Netflix.
Yeah.
So that's comfort, I suppose. But Daengjang Jjigae is my thing. Yeah.
So a while back in the dinner party, you were talking about letting that inner kid kind of come free. And so I wanted to bring on stage Barrel of Monkeys. I'm going to let them explain to you what they do. But one of the three singers, Jesse Oliver, there's also Elizabeth Levy and Gwen Tulin. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. But Jesse Oliver, one of the three, she's a graduate from the Chicago Academy for the Arts, which is why I wanted to bring them here, because I love the Academy. And I love that we were able to support them tonight. And if you don't know about them, they're truly a wonderful place. So Jesse, who's in the middle of the three, I don't know which one of you wants to explain what Barrel of Monkeys does, but...
I'd be happy to.
Okay, there's Elizabeth Levy, the director.
Yes, so Barrel of Monkeys, we are an arts education theater company of professional actors who go into Chicago public elementary schools and teach creative writing. And then we adapt the students' writing into original performances that we then perform at the schools and for the public. We do a show every Monday night at the Neo Futurist Theater called That's Weird Grandma, which is a collection of which is a collection of stories written by students all over Chicago. We work with 3rd through 5th graders, and we adapt those stories. So we're going to do a story tonight written by a 5th grader from the Dewey School of Excellence. Her name is Tamara M.
Right.
She wrote about a character named Horse Wolf, and we turned it into a song.
I think this is so fantastic what they do, just working off of children's ideas, and this song is so great. You'll see the free-form creativity that happens from this 5th grader. Take it away, ladies.
Horse Wolf, my job. like a shrimp.
From this fifth grader's song. So thank you to them. Thank you to the Academy, Chicago Academy for the Arts, for being here and for supporting us. And I love them and I love what they do. Yeah. Thank you to City Winery for having us here and for all that great wine, because they are so great and I love them. Please take a look at your screens for everyone here who has participated. It takes a lot of people to put this show together. So thank you to my team. I want to thank Charles Adler for being so smart and interesting. Yeah. You get to go to a private party tomorrow night with Corinthia and myself.
Boom.
At the Boom is Right.
You can't come.
You too can go.
At the
Hilton Asmus Gallery at 702 North Wells. They're having a private reception of all of Corinthia's photographs and also Patty Boyd's photographs
and Henry Dills' photographs.
So yeah. Private party tomorrow night. You're invited. Come with me. And also the first person who put out a tweet... Allie, who was the first person?
The Elastic MTG.
The Elastic MTG, you won 3 CDs by Tiffany Monique, whom I love, and I hope that we all support, and she's just a great person and so talented. And you also won 2 tickets to That's Weird Grandma. So you want to definitely see Barrel of Monkeys and That's Weird Grandma. I also want to thank Chef Chaz. City of Chicago culturally, who can keep track? But just in case you have some room in your calendar, I'm going to be speaking at Chicago Gourmet on September 26th. I'll be at the Host Beautifully tent with Stella Artois, so I hope you come by. Chicago Gourmet, what's not to like? And then Match.com has asked me to do a singles dinner party. So if you know some people who are looking to hook up, I do this for Match.com for singles only, and that's going to be on October 2nd if you want to go to that. And then we're going to be back at City Winery in November, so... Thanks for being here, everyone. I super appreciate it. My name is Elizabeth Alfano, and see you later this fall.
Yeah, Elizabeth.